Hello friends, welcome to Smart Catalyst. Today we'll be seeing the current affairs of 17 November 2018. The topics we'll be covering for prelims are these six. First three are interrelated topics concerning women's safety. First one is about National Commission for Women. Second one is about Nirbhaya Fund of India. Third one is about the POSCO Act of 2012. Fourth article talks about tropical cyclone formation. Fifth one is about Indian Naval Ship of Arihant. And the last article talks about Asian Development Bank. The first article we'll be seeing is about National Commission for Women, and this article was taken from PIB. Recently, the National Commission for Women organized a meet in order to review the law of sexual harassment of women at workplaces 2013. So, in order to strengthen the law to make workplaces more safer for women. So, in this context, we have to know what National Commission for Women is for the prelims. So, this National Commission for Women is a statutory body. So, this body was formed as per the provisions of a law. This law is National Commission for Women Act. So, this act was enacted in the year 1990 and the body came into functioning in the year 1992. What were the purposes for which this body was constituted? The main functioning of this body is to review the constitutional provisions to safeguard women. So, Indian Constitution offers various provisions like Article 14, which provides equality of women, Article 21, right to live with dignity to all the citizens of India. To legally safeguard those constitutional provisions is an important mandate of this body. Second is to recommend legal remedies for the problems and also to facilitate redressal mechanisms for the grievances. It also advises the government on all the policies that are affecting women. On overall basis, this body functions under the administrative control of Ministry of Women and Child Development. However, this body is a permanent body with a chairperson and five members. Now let's see the constitution of this commission. So this body, as I said before, is headed by a chairperson, and the chairperson is nominated by the central government, and the person must be an eminent person in the cause of women. And the body also consists of five members and also a member secretary. The member secretary is also nominated by the central government just like the chairperson. He or she is usually a civil servant of All India Service Cadre, usually with a good experience in the field of management and social movements. The five members who are part of the body are also nominated by the central government. They come from various fields, having very good experience in law, trade unionism, organization of industry, increasing potential of women, economic development, health, as well as social welfare. The ambit of National Commission for Women is it extends to whole of India except the state of Jammu Kashmir. In the past few years, National Commission for Women has taken considerable step to improve the digital literacy of women. It has even partnered with Facebook to increase their digital penetration, thereby empowering women in rural areas. The next article we'll be seeing is fresh proposal for expenditure under Nirbhaya Fund. So this article was taken from the newspaper Indian Express. So here the news is that the Empowerment Committee of Nirbhaya Fund, which functions under Women and Child Development Ministry, has approved three major projects in order to enhance women's safety. So before getting into the new proposals, we have to know what Nirbhaya Fund is. So this Nirbhaya Fund was created in the year 2013 by Ministry of Finance. So it is a dedicated fund for the implementation of various initiatives for enhancing the safety and security of women. So it is a non-lapsable corpus fund functioning under Nodal Ministry of Women and Child Development. And overall, the fund is monitored by a special empowerment committee of officers under Secretary of Women and Child Development. The money from this fund has been utilized by various states for various initiatives to enhance the safety of women. Few such initiatives are one-stop center, that is the Shakti centers to aid women. Second is universalization of women helpline. Third is Mahila Police Volunteer Scheme in the state of Haryana. There's also a special Central Victim Compensation Fund, which is created under Nirbhaya Fund, under CRPC article of 357A. There's also a proposed project called as Abhaya Project in the state of Andhra Pradesh to enhance the safety of women during the transportation. So as we saw before, this fund is monitored by the Empowerment Committee, and the Empowerment Committee suggested three important proposals. And one proposal among them is setting up a fast track special courts. As we all know, Indian judiciary is having high number of pendency cases, and in order to reduce the burdening of judicial system in India, special fast track courts are proposed to be set up to deal with the pendency cases with respect to rape, child abuse, which are registered under POSCO Act. So now we'll see what POSCO Act is. So this POSCO Act stands for Protection of Children from Sexual Offences Act. So this act was enacted in the year 2012. So according to this POSCO Act, a child is any person below the age of 18. So this definition of POSCO Act is on par with United Nations Convention on Rights of Child. However, another point to note here is, according to Criminal Law Amendment Ordinance, of 2018, a child is any person below the age of 12. So we have to know that both this ordinance and POSCO Act are mutually contradicting each other. The main purpose of enacting POSCO Act is to protect children from offences like sexual abuse, sexual harassment and child pornography. In the context of increasing awareness about child harassment and sexual abuse via #MeToo campaign, this law becomes even more important. The law also brings in a child-friendly system for trial of children, and it also safeguards the interest of child at every stage of the judicial process. So by safeguarding the interest of child, it ensures that the privacy of child is protected, and also confidentiality of the child and his or her family is also taken care of. The next article we'll be seeing is tropical cyclone formation. So we all know Tamil Nadu coast has been struck by cyclone called as Gaja. In this context, one has to know the process of formation of tropical cyclones. So as the name states, tropical cyclones, they are capable of being formed only in tropical areas. And these tropical cyclones, they cause high devastating torrential rains on the coast of various cities. For the formation of this tropical cyclone, certain prerequisites are required. First one is the temperature. So tropical cyclone can be formed only in tropical areas because the temperature in the tropical areas are pretty high when compared to temperature in temperate areas. For the formation of tropical cyclones, minimum of 27 degrees Celsius is required. And second important condition for formation of tropical cyclone is the presence of Coriolis force. So what is this Coriolis force? So this Coriolis force is the force created due to rotation of Earth, and it deflects a moving object in the direction of right in northern hemisphere and in south in southern hemisphere. Third condition is the tropical cyclone, they usually form at the latitude of about 10 to 20 degree north and south from the equator. This is because only at this area, both temperature as well as Coriolis force condition are satisfied for formation of tropical cyclones. So in tropical areas, as the temperature rises, the air mass rise, and which leads to condensation and formation of clouds. And increase the condensation leads to formation of dense clouds known as cumulonimbus clouds. So this cumulonimbus clouds, they draw the moisture from the water body, and they continue to grow until they reach the land, wherein they undergo a process called as landfall. So this landfall occurs when the moisture supply for the formation of cloud is cut down, which leads to heavy rains in the coastal parts of India. And these tropical cyclones, they occur only in eastern part of the continents all over the world. So in this diagram, there are three important parts to be noted. One, this area is called as eye of the cyclone. This is eye wall, and this is the outer area. So this eye of the cyclone is constituted by low pressure area. Due to low pressure, there is subsiding warm air mass, which is due to the low adiabatic pressure created due to compression of air. And this area is constituted by calmness. There's no rain or any wind flow in this area. However, these two areas, they are constituted by torrential rains because of the formation of cumulonimbus clouds. Usually in tropical cyclones, they blow at the rate of 250 km per hour, which can have devastating effects on the coastal areas. And this tropical cyclone, they are known by different names in different parts of the world. For example, they are known as cyclones in Indian Ocean. They are known by the name of hurricanes in Atlantic. They are known by the names of typhoons in Western Pacific and South China Sea. And they are also known by the name of Willy Willy in Western Australia. The next article we'll be seeing is INS Orient. So India recently launched its indigenously designed nuclear submarine called as INS Orient. So by launching this INS Orient, India successfully completed its nuclear triad. What is nuclear triad? Okay, nuclear triad is a facility of a country wherein it can launch its nuclear missiles or weapons successfully from land, water, as well as from air. So India already had its land and air potential to launch nuclear weapons. By now successfully testing INS Orient, it successfully completed its nuclear triad. So let's see what INS Orient is. So this INS Orient is a nuclear submarine. So this INS Orient is a nuclear submarine which uses pressurized water reactor. So it uses 34% to 40% of enriched uranium to run the turbine, which in turn runs the whole submarine. So what is the advantage of using nuclear submarine when compared to normal diesel run submarine? So what is the purpose of this nuclear submarine? So earlier India had only diesel run submarine. So this diesel run submarine, they require oxygen for combustion. And for the oxygen supply, they need to resurface for once in few hours. So however, this INS Orient does not require oxygen, so it can stay underwater for hours together without any detection from the enemy countries. So this INS Orient is manufactured in such a way to accommodate ballistic missile of Agni 3. So this ballistic missile is a 5000 km range missile which is capable of targeting both Pakistan as well as China. And this whole facility of INS is built indigenously by a shipbuilding center in the port city of Visakhapatnam. The next article we'll be seeing is about Asian Development Bank. This article was taken from the newspaper PIB. So what is Asian Development Bank? So Asian Development Bank was constituted in the year 1966 as a multilateral agency in the models of World Bank. So it even has similar weightage system like World Bank, and it is headquartered in Manila in Philippines. So it is a bank which has Japan and USA as a major players, and the bank functions by borrowing from international capital markets with its own capital as guarantee. So the main areas of Asian Development Bank to provide credit include large scale projects for the causes of social as well as environmental development. So recently Asian Development Bank and Energy Efficiency Services Limited of India, they together constituted a fund called as Energy Efficiency Revolving Fund. So this fund is mainly to aid projects concerning e-mobility, thereby offering environmental protection. The other important projects of Asian Development Bank also include India, Myanmar and Thailand Trilateral Highway Project. With respect to Asian Development Bank, India has fourth highest weightage. It has about 6% of total voting rights. So there are 67 members in Asian Development Banks, and out of 67 members, 48 come from Asia region. And the rest members of Asian Development Bank are the developed countries of the world. So the Asian Development Bank is also dedicated to reduce poverty in the region of Asia and Pacific. Thus, by reducing poverty, it aims to promote inclusiveness in economy as well as environment, thereby bringing in regional development in the area of Asia Pacific. The funding from Asian Development Bank is both for sovereign countries and also for private parties. Asian Development Bank aims to achieve its mandate by providing loans at lower interest, that is soft loans to poor countries and hard loans to middle income as well as to middle income countries. Topics for the mains are these four. First one is about International Labour Organization's new index. Second article talks about the vacancies in subordinate courts in India. And the third article is about Indian economy in general. Fourth article is about India's Act East policy and China's OBOR. The first article we'll be seeing is 41% Indian employees feel they are poorly paid, says an International Labour Organization study. This article was taken from the newspaper Mint. So in a recent study conducted by International Labour Organization in Asia-Pacific region called as Asia-Pacific Employment and Social Outlook 2018, it reports that about at least 930 million workers in the Asia-Pacific region, which also includes India, they feel that they are underpaid, which means that they are having a vulnerable employment situation. So, on comparing India with its neighbors, India stands only behind Bangladesh, Pakistan and Mongolia. So, according to this report, despite a considerably impressive economic growth rate in Asia-Pacific region for past 1.5 decades, this problem of low wages as well as less conducive working condition still prevails in Asia-Pacific region. This report also provides a detailed Indian scenario of the labor conditions. The report placed a special emphasis on female participation rate in Indian workforce. So the labor force participation rate, despite India's strong economic growth between 2004 and 2011, it has still slumped by a percentage of 6, which is an area of concern here. The report also talks about low penetration of social security. As we all know, about 70% of Indian workforce still comes from informal sector, which has low penetration of social security. It has limited the fallback options of the workers, especially in the post-retirement period. The report also spoke about the care expenditure in the post-retirement period. So, care expenditure, which mainly constitutes a health expenditure. So, the report states that India in the year 2013, it spent only about $100 at purchasing power parity rate for the post-care expenditure. However, this is very, very low in comparison to other developing nations such as Japan and Republic of Korea, which almost spends $8,000 per person. So this solution can be addressed by increasing formalization of Indian economy. By increasing formalization, more workforce will be brought in under the ambit of social security, which in turn will reduce the alienation of the workers. The next article we'll be seeing is a crippling shortage on vacancies in quote. This is taken from the newspaper Hindu. So we all know that there's chronic shortage of judges in various levels of judiciary. This includes both higher courts as well as the subordinate courts. So according to the government data, nearly quarter of total number of posts in subordinate courts are vacant. And according to the data released by judiciary, about 5,000 of total 22,000 positions in judiciary remain vacant. In order to address this mismatch, the CJI of India has questioned the state government and also the administrators of various high courts for delay in filling these vacancies. So it is also to remember that in the year 2007, Supreme Court released detailed guidelines in order to address the vacancy issue prevailing in various levels of the judiciary. And another important point to be noted in case of judicial vacancies is the regional disparity in case of vacancies. So, the highly populated and less developed states such as UP and Bihar, the vacancy level is very, very high. However, in case of more developed states, the vacancy level is significantly low. So, let's see the reasons for this present crisis. Before getting into the reasons, one needs to know the procedure by which the sub-judicial judges are appointed. Okay, there are two main judicial positions in the lower judiciary. One is district judges, the other is subordinate judicial officers. So, according to the provisions of the constitution, the district judges are appointed by the governor by consulting the members of High Court. However, the subordinate judicial officers, they are too appointed by the governor as per the norms framed by the governor in consultation with both higher court as well as state public service commission. Okay, let's now see the problems. Most of the states in India, they are highly tardy for process of calling the application, holding a recruitment test, declaring the result and also allocating funds for conducting the exams for appointment of the judges. So, there was a survey conducted by Vidhi Center for Legal Policy according to which it states that almost all the states of India exceeded the time limit allocated by the Supreme Court of India to recruit the judges. So all this situation, it calls for massive infusion of not just funds but also manpower to conduct the exam and to recruit the judges. We all know that Indian judicial system, it almost has 2.5 crore pending cases in the lower judiciary, and the number of under trials are also highly increasing, which leads to overcrowding of prisons. And the subcourts in India, they play a very important role, especially to the life of a common man. This is because they are the first points of conducting trials, and they also address the civil disputes concerning common man. So any failure to allocate human and financial resources will cripple the whole judicial system in India. This will delay the justice, and the justice delayed is justice denied. The final article we'll be seeing is getting the economy back on track, and this appeared in today's Hindu, and it was written by Mr. Subramaniam Swamy. So the article, it quotes certain important facts about today's economy. So let's see the facts. The first one is about the growth rate of Indian economy. The growth rate of Indian economy based on GDP has declined over past two financial years. And this financial year too, the growth rate is expected to decline, which is an area of concern. So the second one is about household savings. So the household savings, they contribute for major share of India's national investment. So this household savings has fallen from 34% to 24% of GDP in the year 2017. So the decline in the household savings rate, it began to fall even before demonetization, and it was accelerated by both demonetization as well as implementation of GST. Third problem Indian economy faces is the non-performing assets. This non-performing assets, it stands at 12% of total advances in case of public sector banks. The lending of public sector banks, especially to the MSMEs under the category of priority sector lending, has caused the highest number of bad loans, and thus transforming the bad loans into non-performing assets recently. The next important issue faced by Indian economy is cut in allocation of funds, especially in the infrastructure sector. So this cut in allocations for the investment projects will definitely affect some of the ongoing important infrastructure projects like Sagarmala, Bharatmala. This may in turn affect various other schemes supporting the infrastructure development like Make in India, which will in turn affect the export potential of India. Because of the decrease in export potential of India, this may cause further stress to already widening trade deficit of India. The next important area of concern for Indian economy is agriculture. So we all know Indian agricultural sector, it employs about 49% of India's population. However, its contribution to GDP is proportionally very, very less. So it suffers from the problem of underperformance. Which in turn affects the export potential of agricultural products to abroad countries. And because of these factors, both exports as well as imports have fallen simultaneously in past 3 years. What are the solutions for these problems that Indian economy is facing? Number one is an individual may be persuaded by the government by giving incentives. Okay, these incentives can come in the form of various welfare schemes, or even it can come in the form of increased tax benefits to individuals. And the individuals and incentives must also be given, and government must also concentrate on giving more incentives to increase the household savings rate. So any economy requires competition for efficient functioning. Only this competition, this coupled with technological innovation, will make an Indian market vibrant, and thus restoring the health of Indian economy. In order to increase the liquidity, especially for the infrastructure project, the banks must lend at lower interest rate in order to infuse more liquidity into the market, especially for the development of infrastructure projects. Thank you.